おはようございます。
おはようございます。
It is a great pleasure and honor to be here. My name, of course, is Joe Zompetti. Please call me Joe. That should be easy. And so this course for the next week will be about policy debates. It will be intense. It will be about debating in English. And I know that all of you will have or should have some experience in debating. If you do not have any experience in debating, that's okay. We are going to start from the beginning. We're going to begin with an understanding about what is debate. We're going to begin with an understanding about what is debate, how do we debate, why do we debate, and what is policy debate. And we will have some practice debates. You will experience a demonstration debate. That will occur a little bit later in the week. And we will have some practices in debating, where each of you will experience some practice in debate. And then at the end of the week, we will have a tournament. So all of you will have some experience in actual debating and in a contest. Okay? We will begin today with some introductions in just a few moments. But I want to begin, before we even get into to the introductions, with just some expectations, some ideas about what this course is really about. All of you will be experiencing this this workshop for a course credit, and hopefully it will mean more than just course credit for you. You will be experiencing this hopefully to learn some valuable English skills. Hopefully you will be experiencing an opportunity to meet new friends. Hopefully you will have an experience in learning some new ideas. You will hopefully have some fun along the way. And hopefully you'll learn some valuable skills. You see, debate is more than just learning how to argue. Debate is really about learning how to think. It's about how to process information in a way that most people do not know how to process information. It's a way to learn how to think in a way that most people don't know how to do. You're able to think in a much quicker way. You're able to process information in a way that you can categorize information. You can evaluate. In other words, you're able to list in benefits versus drawbacks or pros and cons. And you can weigh. Okay, and this kind of a measuring system. You can think more quickly, and you're able to make decisions at much faster, more rapid kinds of ways. When you are in a situation in your friends or in your peers, you're able to make these kinds of decisions. And your friends and your peers aren't able to do this, you are going to be much better than they are. You are going to have these skills, and they are not going to have these skills. You are going to be better than them. This will make you have more value. You are going to be able to process this information in ways that they are not going to be able to do. And hopefully, you're going to be able to have fun doing it. So, not only will you be able to have course credit, not only will you hopefully make some friends, not only will you have some fun, but hopefully you will learn some skills, okay? Those are the good things, all right? But with any process of learning, there's also going to be work involved, okay? And with any kind of debating, there's going to be some work. And in policy debate, there's going to be research. And there's a reason why when you walked into the door, it said intensive debate workshop. I don't know if you've looked at the... May I borrow this? I don't know if you've looked at this yet. But it says intensive course on policy debate. Okay? And the schedule here says intensive course on policy debate. And you will notice on page 2 here, it lists the schedule. Each day, except for Wednesday, is a full day. Okay? And every day, except for Wednesday, we will have a full day of workshops. And each day we will have a crammed full day of training. In addition to that, we will be doing research, which means you will need to be doing a fair amount of reading and research on a particular topic, which we will talk about later today on what that topic will be. Okay. This will be, for some of you, it may be something that you are not familiar with, something new, okay? You may not be used to this kind of research, the amount of reading and research that is required for policy debate may be new to you. We will try to explain how this can be fun and how it can be exciting. But for some of you, it still may be quite intensive. And so just want to let you know up front that it is intensive and it may be new. But at the same time, think about all the benefits you will also get from this. Okay? Okay? Now... So this is what the course is really about, okay? Are there any questions so far? Okay. One last thing before we get into introductions, and that is, I am a very laid-back professor. What does that mean? That means that I am easygoing. I am very open. I don't know what it is. Well, I have an idea what some of you are probably are used to in terms of your teachers. But in the United States, the way I teach is I usually sit down when I teach, and we sit in a big circle. I don't usually teach like this. I usually expect my students to read before class, and we all learn from each other. I do not usually come to class with the idea of with the idea that I know everything, because I don't know everything. I do know quite a bit. I've written several books. I've taught debate in lots of different countries. In fact, I was in Fukuoka. In 2009, I thought it was 2007, but Cynthia corrected me, which just proves that I don't know everything, right? But Professor Inoue invited me in 2009 to teach in Fukuoka. And I've been in Japan 6 times. I've also been in Europe several times. I have written several books on debate. I've been a debate coach. I have been a debater for almost 25 years. So I know a little bit about debate. But I don't know everything there is to know about debate. And I can learn a few things about debate from other people. So I enjoy listening and talking to other people about debate. So I usually like to sit in a circle and listen to other people about debate. I've not been to every country on the planet. I've been to England, but I would love to talk to Daniel about his experiences about debate. I have not been to the Philippines, so I would love to talk to Mark about his experiences about debate in the Philippines. I've been to Thailand, but only for 2 days. So I would love to listen to these young guys about their experiences about debate in Thailand. So you understand what I mean? Okay? Just because I have been involved with debate for over 25 years, I don't know everything there is to know about debate from all over the world, right? What does that mean? That means that I can help you with debate, but I know that you all have your own ideas, your own experiences, and we can learn and share with each other. If you have a question, or if you don't know what I mean when I say something, or if I say a word and you don't know what I mean, particularly because maybe English is not your first language, or if I say something too fast, or if I talk about a concept that you don't understand, please, please interrupt me. Do not wait. Do not wait till the end of the day, because you might lose that thought. Feel free to interrupt me at that moment in time. Do not be afraid to share a thought. It's okay if we stop at a moment's notice, you know, if we stop a particular moment in time, if we delay and we have to go back, that's okay. If we need to go back and we are lose track of time, that's okay. All right? Nothing is more important than satisfying your curiosity. Nothing is more important than maintaining your interest, because that's why we are here. Okay? So, having said that, I would like to know more about you. So, let's have some introductions. So let's begin with session 2, basics of debate and argumentation. So we are now going to begin and jump right into the basics of policy debate. So it will be useful for you if you now use the handouts, okay, if you have this in front of you. You can use this for notes and as a guide for the lecture. Again, feel free to interrupt me if you have questions or if I go too fast. All right? So I want to begin with when someone says the word debate, what comes to mind to you?
Argument.
Argument. Okay, good. So argument. What else?
Convince audience.
Okay.
Convince audience.
Convince audience?
Yeah.
Okay. So, arguments? Convincing? What else?
Evidence.
Evidence, okay. What else? Anything else?
What else? Anything else?
Question.
What's that?
Policy.
Policy.
Question.
Question? Okay. Anyone else?
Rebuttals.
Rebuttals? Someone else over here? Came up?
Controversial topic.
Controversy? Rebuttal?
Comparison.
All right. Okay. What about you?
Summary.
What's that?
Summary.
The summary. All right. I think debate covers all of those, I think, pretty well. It's good. One thing that I think might be missing clash. In order for a debate to exist, is clash. Clash of ideas. Controversy almost gets at that. When, other than controversy, and maybe rebuttal, somewhat maybe with comparison, the rest of these words are almost unidirectional. You could almost have just maybe one side with all of these, right? A debate implies two sides, right? You have to have at least two sides, and that's what a debate is really about. In other words, if you just have one side, you just have persuasion, right? That's what rhetoric is. Right? Rhetoric is the Aristotle said defined rhetoric as any available means of persuasion, right? And certainly debate involves persuasion and rhetoric, but it involves multiple sides, right? And debate is not does not have is not a debate unless you have clash, conflicting ideas, right? And in fact, when we have academic debate, it's not a good debate if you don't have clash. And for any of you who've had debates before, or if you've judged debates before, you know that they're not good debates if you don't have clash, right? So we'll get into that more as we talk about this. So in any case, when we think about debates in kind of our everyday lives, we know that we often think of argument, right? We can have a debate with our friends, debate with our parents, the debate with our significant others, and what that usually means is some sort of heated argument. That's not what we're talking about this week. What we're talking about is a systematic way of reasoned discourse. Okay? A systematic way of thinking about things. It is an academic exercise. It is a way for us to think about an idea so that we can come to conclusions about a topic of controversy. That's what we are doing this week. It involves us talking about a topic of controversy in a systematic way. Okay? We are going to agree about an issue of controversy. In fact, this week, we are going to be talking about the Japanese death penalty. That's going to be our topic of controversy. And because we're going to agree about that topic, We are also going to agree about talking about it in a certain way. We're going to have rules so that it's going to be fair. We're going to have sides. We're going to have a pro and a con. That's going to be called an affirmative and a negative. In other styles of debate, they're called, sometimes they're called a pro and a con. Sometimes they're called a negative or a house and what are they called, Daniel?
Proposition,
right? Sometimes they're called different things in different styles, okay? But essentially it's a pro and a con, okay? But they're essentially rules, okay? And we agree to those rules because it's fair, all right? It's a systematic way. Why do we do it this way? Well, we do it that way because we want to be able to maximize. We want to be able to, in other words, we want to be able to get the most out of our time and be able to learn as much as we can out of our experience. Why? Because it's an academic exercise. We're not in this to beat people up, right? It's not a fight. It's not a way for us to show who is bigger and stronger. If it were, I would always win. it's not a game in that sense. Okay? It is a game in the sense that we can have fun, but it's not a game in that kind of a sense. It's a game so that we can learn. And but it's a game so that we can broaden our mind, and it's a game so that we can learn how to think. But we need to make sure that there are rules so that it can be fair. Okay. So having said that, it's a process, a systematic process about a topic of controversy. Okay. Now, why do we do it? Why do we do it? Okay. We have to do this research, you know, we have to do these classes. Why would we do this? All right. There are several reasons why we would do this. Can you think of some? Why would we do this thing called debate? Why are you doing this thing called debate? Someone twisting your arm to do it? Why would you do it? Yes, good. Make decisions. Excellent, because maybe not this week, right? Like, the Japanese diet is not going to decide at the end of this week whether or not to get rid of the death penalty, right? But at some point in time, they may decide, right, to either continue with the death penalty or not, right? And so they are going to make these arguments, the same as you guys are. You all are going to be simulating or role-playing the same as the Japanese legislature, right? So just like them, you will be simulating or role-playing just like they would, right? So that's good. So it's like making decisions. So why else would you be debating? What are some other reasons?
To create fairness.
Create what?
Fairness. Fair.
Fairness.
Yes.
Okay. To what end? For what reason?
Right. We have two sides to argue with each other to make the decision become like fair,
mm-hmm.
the most fair.
Okay, so if you have to make a decision, this is debate is one way to make it fair. Is that what you're saying?
Yeah.
Okay. So it creates a fair playing field. Is that kind of what you mean?
Yep.
Okay. Why else would you debate? Why else would you engage in argumentation? Why else are you here? Okay. Ah, very good. Critical thinking. Critical thinking skills. Good. All right, let me help you out with the other ones. Okay? Debating can help with democracy. Okay? Debating can also help with reducing uncertainty, particularly with the research skills, right? The more you research, the more knowledge you gain. So it can help reduce uncertainty. It can also help you discover more truths about the world. Okay. So debate can be a wonderful activity. It can open up all sorts of ideas and horizons, and can really, I believe, can really help provide new ways of thinking, and can really provide new ways of knowledge, and will help us to improve our communication skills. Right, you have to get up and speak in front of people. Right? So, all sorts of things. Now, what is debate? What is it? I've already mentioned that it is a systematic way of thinking. There is a topic, right, that we have, that we will be debating about. A controversial area. Now, there is a broad topic area. We can envision or imagine all sorts of different controversial areas, right? Global warming, death penalty, euthanasia, not young people in Asia, but killing people, right? That was supposed to be funny. How about we could debate? How about racism? That's a broad area, right? How about the United States military policy, right? Because we're always doing something, right? Americans are always doing something. American fast food, right? That's always a problem. These are broad areas, but they're too broad to talk about in an academic debate. Because academic debates, in order for us to have any meaningful discussion, must occur in a limited time span, right? We only have a limited amount of time to have a discussion. Usually it's about 45 minutes, maybe an hour, maybe at most 2 hours, depending on the format of the debate. Okay, different styles have different time spans. At most, like American policy debates can be at most about 2 hours. Ours is not going to be that long, so don't start freaking out. Okay. The ours is, you can see on page 3 here, ours is only going to be about, what is that, about 45 minutes maybe? So you can see that there is no way we could discuss something like global warming, right, in 45 minutes. That's way too broad of a topic to discuss in 45 minutes. So we would have to narrow it, narrow such a broad topic, to have a meaningful discussion, okay? So what would we do to narrow that topic down, okay? In an academic competitive debate, we would narrow an issue of controversy into what we would call a proposition, okay? This is also called two other terms, depending on what style of debate you do, okay? This is also called a motion. And in policy debate, it's also called a resolution. Resolution. Okay? In parliamentary debate, it's called a motion. In policy debate, parliamentary debate is called a motion. In policy debate, it's called a resolution. Okay? All three of these terms mean the same thing. All this means is we take an issue of controversy, okay, a broad-based issue, we narrow it down into a specific topic area. Okay? So, for our purposes, for this week, instead of saying something broad, we are going to debate something specific. We are going to be debating resolved. Now, I hope I get this right. You know what it is specifically, right? It's that the Japanese death penalty is not. Okay, what is it?
Japan
should
abolish this term.
Okay, so what is it?
And Japan should.
That Japan should
abolish this term.
Should abolish the in academic debate, these things matter, actually. So resolve that Japan should abolish the death penalty. This is what you will be debating. The death penalty. DP means death penalty. Okay? Now, this is important because now that we know what the resolution is, we now can discuss what the stock issues are. I will not bore you with the details of how we came up with this concept of stock issues. The stock issues come from the Latin stasis from Cicero and whatnot. Essentially, stock issues help us to determine what are considered the burden of proof. Okay? We get this from the burden of proof, obviously, help us to constitute this notion of what is necessary as if this were a court of law. Okay? We have a couple of folks here who study law, don't we? Who's studying law? Somebody who's studying law? Yeah, okay. You know something about stasis, then, don't you?
I hope.
You hope? Yeah, okay. Okay, so the affirmative side, and we're going to talk a little bit about this in a minute, okay? The affirmative side, who will be supporting the resolution, okay? So the affirmative side will be arguing that Japan should, in fact, abolish the death penalty, has to meet a burden of proof, okay? They have to meet four critical stock issues. Those four stock issues are solvency, harms, but also related significance, inherency, and what's known as topicality. So, burden of proof. And I just abbreviate that BOF. If you were, so there's somebody else in here who is in medical school, right? Or studying medicine. Who's studying medicine in here? Come on, who's studying medicine? Thank you. If you want to make an analogy, you all know what an analogy is? If you want to make an analogy to somebody who is sick, like Kenji, right? If the current system is sick and you're trying to cure them and want to make them feel better, right? Like if they are sick, and you have the cure to their sickness, you could think of this as a cure. All right, I'll use a different color. And I'm only going to share this with you if this makes it easier for you to understand. Okay? So, because sometimes these terms are somewhat difficult to understand. Okay? So, if you think about this as a current problem where they're sick, okay? So think of this as sickness, all right? So instead of it being a harm, think of this as being sick. So the current system is sick. And instead of you having a solvency or a plan to solve the harm, you've got a cure. And instead of you talking about an inherence, in other words, inherency is the idea that there is you can identify the culprit or identify the blame. Instead of that, you can talk about the diagnosis. Okay? And topicality is a whole separate issue. This has nothing to do really with medicine. Topicality is, in terms of law, just means that is the same idea as jurisdiction. I'll talk about topicality in a second. Okay? So let's talk about these three first in terms of your burden of proof. Okay? So if you're the affirmative, and again, if I'm confusing anybody, stop me. Okay? Let's go back to this. Okay, we've got the topic. And the affirmative needs to argue that the death penalty should be abolished. This should be relatively easy for the affirmative. Okay? First of all, they need to prove that there is some sort of culprit or there's somebody to blame. That would be the diagnosis or the inherency. They need to prove that there is a law on the books, that there's something that currently allows people to be punished by death. I don't know what that is off the top of my head, but there has to be something, some kind of law that allows people to be sentenced to death. Okay? That should be easy to find. You could probably get on Google and quickly find some law, some act that allows people to be punished by death. Okay? And then in your speech, you would simply say the blah, blah, blah act allows people to be punished by death. Okay? I, as the affirmative team, think that piece of legislation should be overturned because I think that should be abolished. That is an inherent barrier. There's something that currently exists that allows people to be punished by death. Okay? That is to blame. Something right now that exists, that is to blame. That's allowing people to be punished by death. That's the diagnosis. Right? Now, why is that bad? Why is it bad that people are being sentenced to death? So what? Who cares? A lot of people would argue that sentencing people to death is a good thing, right? Some people would argue that punishing people to death, that the death penalty is actually a good thing because it creates deterrence. Creates justice. Some people create such heinous crimes in a civilized society that they should be sentenced to death. Well, I disagree with that. That I think that allowing the state to murder people is one of the most evil things a country could do. And that I think that allowing a country to kill its own citizens actually legitimizes and creates a cycle of violence. It actually endorses murder. It gives criminals an okay to go ahead and kill other people. Because if a country can kill people, then why shouldn't criminals kill people? That's what I think is wrong. That's why I think it's a harm. It's hypocritical. Why should we say it's bad for criminals to kill people when our own country kills people? Now, I'm not sure how an affirmative is going to win significance when Japan only kills 3 people per year. Maybe 3 people is 3 people too many. I don't know. That's maybe a debate to have. But in any case, you see how you can win inherency because clearly there's a law on the books that makes it legal. An affirmative can win that, you know, perhaps it's harmful. I mean, there's a debate to be had. And how can you win solvency? Well, you abolish it or you don't. Now, how is it topical? That's a jurisdiction issue. Jurisdiction is simply this. The affirmative has to prove that their plan, okay, that their plan to abolish the death penalty fits within the resolution. In other words, they have to argue that their plan of action is precisely what the resolution mandates. They can't argue that the U.S. should abolish the Japanese death penalty, or that the United States should abolish the United States death penalty. They can't argue that Japan should get rid of genetically modified organisms. They have to argue that Japan should abolish its death penalty. They can't argue that Japan should abolish the death penalty in 2020. They can't argue that Japan should abolish the death penalty only for juveniles. They have to argue that Japan should abolish the death penalty. Okay. Now, the affirmative could be creative and argue that Japan should abolish the death penalty only for juveniles. But then the negative could argue that, well, you really should really abolish all of the death penalty, not just for juveniles. But then the debate becomes an argument only about topicality. And the debate really gets ugly. And nobody really likes to have a debate just about that. And we will discourage you for having a debate just about that. We will encourage you to only have a debate about solely the death penalty. Okay? Now, are there any questions at this point? It's pretty straightforward, really. I can't really think of a better topic for people just getting involved with policy debate. This is a pretty straightforward topic. Any questions about the stock issues? Now, there is an exercise that we can do now. If you look on page 3, in bold print, there's this thing that says exercise. In small groups, we can get in small groups, and we can make a list of controversial topics that you can think of, topics that people argue about every day. And then you can develop resolutions from those large topic areas. Does that make sense? So remember, I talked about those like large topic areas like global warming, racism, and then how would you think of more specific resolution areas? How would you make those more narrow, more debatable? Okay? We can take like about 10 minutes. Does that make sense? This helps you, first of all, brainstorm. So brainstorm large controversial topic areas. But then it also gets you to think more critically to define or narrow those into more debatable topic areas. Okay? And also gets you to get a little more energized. All right? So 10 minutes. Get into small groups of maybe like 4. So break up into 4 people. Let's wrap this up. So did each group come up with a couple, at least 2 different topic areas? How about this group over here, Mark's group? Did you come up with at least 2? Yeah? Over here, at least 2? Beta, at least 2? Okay. All right. I'm not interested in the topic areas that you did come up with. What I am interested in is what did you learn from this? Okay? Can you tell me what you learned from this? Catherine?
Yeah. That values are kind of not seen superficially, but underneath they're kind of pushing your word choice and the things that you think are important, so cultural values.
Okay. Okay. Very good. What else?
Teamwork.
James, right?
Yes, James.
Teamwork?
Yes.
All right. Good. Yeah. And I saw that I kind of overheard this group, and I went over here to this group, and there was a lot of that going on with these two groups. What else? Did anybody think about the process?
I think she's probably too shy to say, but, you know, I think the process of going through these topic areas kind of made her understand there's a difference between something that might be people generally discuss and actually moving towards making a resolution. So for her, I think I could see kind of moments of discovery in her process of, oh, it's, you can't just say, oh, people use the internet too much and become this or that. You know, it has to be something, like you mentioned, that is changeable.
Right, right, so, definitely. Yeah. Okay. Good. All right. Well, let me help you out a little bit. Okay. So when I noticed that some of you kind of cheated a little bit, which is okay. You know, that there was no, it wasn't. There was no method behind my madness with this exercise. Okay. But when I asked you to start off with a general topic area, all right, and then move to a more narrow, specific resolution, okay, normally when we think about moving from a general to a specific, in terms of a reasoning process, what do we call that? In terms of reasoning, when we move from general to specific, what do we call that?
Goal.
No? Close, but general to specific is what? What did you say, Mark?
Deductive.
Did you say deductive?
Yeah.
Yes, it is deductive. I thought you said inductive.
No.
No. Yes. Deductive. Now, some of you cheated, okay? Some of you had a specific topic area and then came up with like a general kind of claim. Which would be veto. Now, I will say that this is not entirely accurate, but this is what we are formally taught, okay? I'm not going to get into all of the specifics because you probably don't need to know all the specifics. This is probably what you really need to know. But in terms of debate, reasoning is only part of the process. The other part of the process is evidence. Okay? And we oftentimes, however, don't really even pay too much attention to the reasoning process. Okay? We don't even know half the time when to identify the reasoning process. In fact, Mark was the only one that yelled out deductive when I said general to specific. This is a problem.
This is a real problem. This is a real problem because, and I'm just going to set aside for a second that we are at a debate workshop. Okay, forget for a moment that we are at a debate workshop. Let's just for a second keep in mind that we are human beings, that we are consumers, that we are citizens. We are people that buy goods and services, that we are people that live in democracies, that we are people that we are people that other people try to persuade us. The problem is, politicians and people that try to persuade us use this method 99% of the time to try to persuade us. And not only do they use that method 99% of the time to persuade us, they use a special type of deductive reasoning to try to persuade us. And it's highly problematic. So not only do we not even, most of the time, question what deductive reasoning is, we don't even question the specific type of deductive reasoning that they use to try to persuade us. And I know that we don't like to read. I know that we live busy lives. And I know that we really don't like to read this guy named Aristotle. But this guy named Aristotle talked about this particular type of argument called an enthymeme. And an enthymeme is a special type of argument known as a syllogism. And a syllogism, and I know it sounds weird, right? But a syllogism is a basic type of argument. And it's essentially A plus B equals C. And an enthymeme is a truncated syllogism. And it's just a missing part of a syllogism. That's all it is. And it's a deductive argument. That's all it is. But it's missing an element. Okay? So in other words, 99% of the time, somebody's persuading us, but there's a missing element in it. So I might say, hey, this yellow piece of chalk is a really awesome piece of chalk, and you should buy it from me. Why should you buy it from me? And I don't even bother to tell you why you should buy it from me. And we live such busy lives, we don't even bother to ask. And we buy it anyway. And we get duped all of the time. This is why, by the way, when I asked earlier why we should learn to debate, and why all of you should stick with this course this week, because it heightens our critical thinking skills, because even though some of you aren't going to like doing some of the research this week, you will learn some of these valuable skills so that you don't get duped into doing this sort of stuff. Because you will learn how to question. You will learn not to get easily manipulated. You will learn how to spot some of these deductive arguments. One of the basic components to arguments is what's known as the Toulmin model. Call it claim equals evidence plus reason. Every argument has three components. Every actual argument. Okay? We make a claim, and it has to be supported with evidence and reasoning. Okay? We've already talked about reasoning. Reasoning can either be deductive or inductive. plus evidence. Evidence is either quotation from a reliable source, statistics, personal experience, demonstration, so it could be gravity, right? Something like that. So any verifiable verifiable demonstration, something of that nature. That plus reasoning is used to support a claim. These components are what is used, what the summation of these, or what we call a complete unit of proof. That's how we define an argument. Okay? Complete unit of proof. A claim is our contention. So I might say, I believe global warming occurs. Now, why do I believe global warming occurs, or how do I believe global warming occurs? Well, I believe global warming occurs because I have seen ice melting, and because I've seen ice melting, that suggests to me that that's unnatural because ice doesn't normally melt. You know? So combining reasoning, ice doesn't normally melt, with empirical evidence that I've seen ice melt equals I believe global warming is happening. Does that make sense? That is a complete unit of proof for me. Okay? So that is a basic argument, basic argument theory. Okay? Now, this is contestable. This is debatable. I have seen ice melt. Where have I seen ice melt? In Colombo, Sri Lanka? In Bangkok, Thailand? It begs a question, doesn't it? And so, just because I have seen ice melt doesn't mean that that is proof that global warming exists. Right? So it is contestable. And it's not, you should not accept such an argument on faith. Right? So what do you think? I've thrown a lot at you, and nobody has asked a single question, and that worries me. I mean, I can go over some more stuff, but let's talk about the affirmative and the negative. All right. All right. If you'll look on page 3, I've already pointed out to you the format of the debates, right? The affirmative goes first. 6 minutes. The affirmative goes first. Why do you think the affirmative goes first?
Proposal.
What's that?
Proposal.
That's right. They have their proposal. And why do you think they give the proposal?
Because they are government.
That's actually not true. Not in policy debate. In parley debates, yes.
Just Oh yes, they start the debate.
Okay, for those of you who have done parley debate, you need to kind of put aside this idea that they are the government, because they are not the government. In fact, it's the opposite. They are the agent of change. Okay? The affirmative is the side that invokes change. They are, in many ways, against the government. Okay? The affirmative side says, current government bad. Okay? The affirmative says, current government wrong. Okay? Right? Because current government should change. So, you don't, if you use that language of parley debate, you can get yourself into real trouble.
Alright.
So, the affirmative wants to argue that change should happen. That's why they go first. So you were right the first time. Proposal. Right? You're all familiar with the sign delta, right? That's why it's also so important in the topic, the resolution, the word should. In policy debate, the word should always, always, always exists. Because the affirmative always, always, always defends the word should. Should happen. They don't defend that it will happen. They defend that it should happen. So, they have to defend the burden of proof. Okay? That's another way of thinking about it. Okay. The negative, another way of thinking about this too, is what are their jobs? What are their roles? The negative's job, the negative's role, is to defend what we would call the status quo, or to attack the ad. Now, what does the status quo mean? Status quo means the current system, the current state of affairs. Okay? So the negative, in most cases, is going to be defending the death penalty. On this count. Now what if there is a situation where the resolution is so morally bankrupt, like maybe in this case, like maybe the death penalty is just so bad that the negative never wants to defend it.
That's why I have here the slash. Okay? The negative does not always have to defend the status quo. Okay? If they want, they don't have to defend the status quo. They don't have to defend the death penalty. If they want, they could just attack the affirmative. Okay? Remember the stock issues, right? And I should have articulated this, I should have mentioned this earlier, and I apologize. The stock issues. What are the stock issues? Remember the acronym, right? What are the stock issues? Someone tell me.
Solvency.
Okay, solvency. What?
Arms.
Inherency. Topicality. Very good. Okay. Now, the burden of proof, right, which is the affirmative's job, the affirmative has to meet all four of these. Okay? If the affirmative fails to meet just one of these, the negative wins. Okay? So the affirmative has to meet all four of these. If they fail, let's say the affirmative fails to meet harms. Okay, the affirmative can win all the other three, but if they fail to meet this one, the negative wins. Okay. Standard basic debate theory is four legs of a chair, and I'm terrible at drawing. And if one of the legs, right, falls, the chair tips over, right? So the affirmative has to win all four. Now, having said that, If the negative doesn't want to defend the status quo, okay, and they just want to attack the affirmative, they can do that. All right, they can just attack, let's say, the solvency. They can just attack the harms. They can just attack the inherency. They don't have to defend the death penalty. Does that make sense? So the negative could still win a debate and not defend why the death penalty is good necessarily. So that's why I did this slash over here. So when you think about the competitive nature of debate, and it is competitive, I mean, there is a winner and a loser. This is how one would win a debate round, okay? But debate is so much more than just winning and losing, right? It's, you know, the winning and the losing is, it's a means to an end. It's really about learning. You know, it's really about, this is really, like I said at the beginning, this systematic way of learning. And how do we get to learning? It's, all of this is about, at the end. And even the topic, right? I mean, imagine, if you will, yeah, I've been at this, you know, for over 25 years, at both high school topics, college topics, international topics, and
parliamentary topics where you have multiple topics at tournaments. You know, that's a lot of topics. And you think about all of those topics. That's a lot of information. And you can't imagine being in situations and someone talking about random things. And you go, yeah, I know something about that. Imagine the dates that you can pick up. So that's something, that's another reason why you're here, isn't it? So. All right. We have 12 minutes before lunch. Surely you have questions. I have never been, particularly at an international event, where English is not the primary language, and there haven't been questions. Daniel.
What does it mean to attack the inerrancy?
Good question. And this is a really good question, too, for this topic. The death penalty in Japan, well, okay, inerrancy, again, is the blame or the, it's usually the law or an attitude that allows the problem to exist. Okay? So in this case, it's the law that allows the death penalty to occur. In Japan, it's very interesting because the death penalty occurs in secret. It's only known after the fact. But it happens. So, I don't know what the law is. I couldn't tell you specifically what it is, but it, you know, it does happen. So what could the negative argue about that? The negative could say, yes, the death penalty exists, but it's virtually not a problem. I mean, it's, you know, the fact that it's done clandestinely is makes it virtually not an issue. The fact that it's done in secret means that I don't know. I mean, I'm sure that there's some kind of argument that can be made, but.
That leads to a question between sentencing, giving decision of death penalty and execution. Mm-hmm. And execution is announced only afterwards, but of course the sentencing, the law court's decision is known, is open public.
Mm. Oh, that's right.
So what's a resolution where, like, the inerrancy would become kind of a big point within the debate?
Oh, yeah.
And I'm struggling to figure out what exactly comes under
it. Yeah, this topic is not really a good one for inerrancy. I'll give you an example. When I debated way back in the day, there was the topic was something to the effect of resolve that the Supreme Court should overturn a decision recognizing the federal constitutional right to privacy or something like that. So there were multiple types of affirmative cases. So the affirmative could choose any kind of case that could overturn a right to privacy. And in that, we actually were negative against a team that overturned a case that had already been overturned. And they didn't know it. They were just idiots. And we happened to know it, and they didn't. So it's very rare.
Inherently doesn't have to be a law, it could also be an attitude.
Yes.
Okay. Because I was thinking that the attitude that the negative produces, that the attitude that most of the Japanese public has is that, you know, this is a bad egg and they're harming the cultural, the body of Japan, so therefore, can the negative use that to say that this is a cultural attitude that Japan has and why it supports the death penalty?
Yeah, you could, except I believe that in Japan the death penalty is quite popular.
Yes. Yeah. So from a negative point of view, would inherency be the attitude that people have to say that the death penalty is okay, therefore there's no need to abolish it? Would that be inherency?
Yeah, except that, no, but that it's, that would go the opposite direction in this case.
So the negative, yeah. The inherency of the negative.
Right, no. In this case, the fact that it is popular is the reason why it's probably legal.
Right. So the negative can use inherency.
No. The negative wouldn't be able to make that argument.
Possibly there are two inherently for the negative may work is if the founder identified the inherently that the Japanese people want the serious criminals get killed, and then even if the
I understand what you're saying. There is a, and you've isolated a paradox in debate, actually. That is an argument that the affirmative would make for why it's currently legal, is because the Japanese public favors it. The negative could then not make that argument for why it should be made illegal. But the negative could make that argument, and this is something that we will probably, and this is something that Scott has done some research on that we will talk about later on in a week. The negative could make that argument as a potential, what we will call, a disadvantage argument. The negative could say the overwhelming population, the Japanese population, think that it's they favor it, it's popular. So if the Japanese government abolish the death penalty, the Japanese people like the death penalty, it would therefore be unpopular politically, it would hurt Japanese politicians politically, and so it would be a politically unpopular move for the Japanese politicians, and would hurt them in the next elections.
And they could argue it's undemocratic as well.
Yes, exactly. And so it would be unfavorable for them in the next elections, and Abe would probably get hurt, or you know, whoever was running. And
well, privacy.
Yes, right. So it would be a political elections argument. So, yeah. So it's a negative consequence argument. Any other questions? You see, these kinds of arguments, they're hypotheticals, you know, risk arguments. Yeah, you will find those are good questions, though. And Daniel, inherency arguments probably will not factor in this topic. All right, well, let's go ahead and break for lunch then, I think. Thank you.